The Jerry Lewis Labor Day Telethon kicks off Sunday night at 9 here on Channel. This is Channel 4, WTVJ, Miami. News Weekend, Update 2. Now here's Bob Mayer.
Good evening. Tropical Storm Floyd has whipped itself up into the third hurricane of the season and now poses a potential threat to the Bahamas. Rich Warren is here with an update.
Well, thank you, Bob. I think the first thing that we should explain is that there are no hurricane watches or warnings out at this time. And as a result, we don't have anything to worry about right now. But Hurricane Floyd is located out north of Puerto Rico. It's starting to move toward the northwest at 10 miles per hour. These are the new coordinates if you're plotting, 39.0 north, 68.0 west. Now, this slow northwestward movement will give it a chance to intensify, so we'll have to keep a close eye on it for the next 24 to 36 hours. With that, the winds are about 75 miles per hour, and they're expected to increase and strengthen just a little bit over the next 24 hours. But the steering currents are very light, and we're not really sure exactly where it's going to go at this time, so we'll keep an eye on it. We'll have more about Floyd a little later on in the broadcast. Bob?
Heavy rains from Tropical Storm Dennis have flooded the Everglades and cut off the food supply to hundreds of Florida deer. Today, in what is being described as a mercy killing, hunters headed out to cut the deer population by one-third. State game officials ordered this special two-day hunt to keep the deer from starving to death. As hunters brought in their catches, state officials' worst fears were realized. The deer are in poor health, undernourished, and their hooves were soft from standing in water for more than 2 weeks. Metro police are searching the Everglades for 8 Haitians who escaped from the Chrome Avenue Refugee Center 2 days ago, and Governor Graham is complaining about conditions at the facility. More from Robert Gilmartin.
The Chrome Avenue Detention Center is quiet now following Thursday's disturbance. 120 refugees have been sent to a federal prison in upstate New York. While these alleged troublemakers have been removed, conditions at the camp remain difficult. More than 1,000 angry Haitians wait in overcrowded facilities for their immigration applications to be processed. Governor Bob Graham says the incident only supports what he said before, that the camp is too crowded.
Chrome Avenue can be operated at a capacity of approximately 525, which is what it's designed to hold. But when it gets up over 1,000, as it was the day of the riot, it's just an impossible situation.
Even as 120 Haitians were being sent to New York, 30 or so Cubans were being brought to the camp, returnees from the recently thwarted invasion of Guantanamo Bay. Graham says unless other states help bear more of the burden of arriving refugees, there will be more violence.
I sent an immediate telegram to the U.S. Attorney General, who is responsible for this issue, underscoring the absolute urgency of the federal government to establish alternative sites outside of Florida so that we do not continue to live with this condition. We had a situation for a few weeks which I think was deceptive. Because of the bad weather, we didn't have a large number of arrivals. Now the weather has turned good again, and we're back at the 7,500 arrivals every day.
Graham was in Miami at a Democratic fundraiser. Although a Graham re-election bid is at least a year away, his handling of the refugee crisis now could be a key issue in the campaign. Robert Gilmartin, Channel 4 News.
Some of Chrome's refugees are likely to be spending this winter in Glasgow, Montana, where temperatures routinely plunge to 40 degrees below zero. The federal government has reached agreement with officials there. The Justice Department said today that if the former Air Force base in Glasgow was good enough for the Strategic Air Command, it's good enough for Caribbean refugees. In Poland today, Solidarity leader Lech Walesa vowed to fight for the survival of the free labor movement. He spoke at the opening of the Independent Union's first national congress in Gdansk. That city is the spiritual home of Solidarity, and its people turned out in large numbers. Walesa declared there was no turning back and that Solidarity would continue its activity with or without government approval. Meantime, some 100,000 Warsaw Pact military personnel are gathered along Poland's border, a grim reminder to Walesa and his followers that Soviet troops are ready to move should the Kremlin so order. White House Press Secretary James Brady went home today for the first time since he was wounded during the assassination attempt on President Reagan more than 5 months ago. James Faruga reports.
When White House Press Secretary James Brady was wheeled out of the hospital, it was thumbs up all the way. The famous Brady spirit is intact. Since March 30th of this year, when he was shot in the head outside a Washington hotel, he has undergone 4 operations, the latest on August 20th. It has been 20 weeks since Brady has seen his house, and family friends who accompanied him today say he has been excited all week about this long-awaited first visit home. The same was true for his wife, Sarah, son, Scott, and neighbors who awaited his arrival. Even though friends had only short notice, the neighborhood was decked out with welcoming signs for the man they all affectionately call the Bear. Although the presidential press secretary was only home a few hours, it was as though he was coming home forever. When he arrived, there were cheers and applause, but there were no words to express what the Brady family really felt. John Ferrugia, CBS News, Washington.
Coming up, Rockwell International pays for the deaths of two space shuttle workers.
Oh, the joys of do-it-yourself pest control. If doing it yourself is doing you in, call Orkin. Orkin's proven monthly service will keep your home free of pests, neatly, affordably, and safely. Don't ask for trouble. Ask for Orkin, big number one.
Do you know me? I've taken ragtime to Vienna and Beethoven to Kalamazoo. And wherever I travel, I use the American Express card. For the same reason, I use a Stradivarius.
To apply for a card, look for this display wherever the card is welcomed.
The American Express card. Don't leave home without it.
One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, 10, 11, 12. Friday the 13th. You may only see it once, but that will be enough. Friday the 13th, rated R.
Now playing at a theater near you.
Here's two good friends. Tonight is kind of special.
Hey, whoa, camp's back there.
Guys, after 3 days of nothing but fish, I vote for a change in the menu. Besides, it's our last night. It's my boat.
All right, so where are we going?
I know a guy down here that serves up a really good steak and a terrific Löwenbräu.
When you want the taste of a truly great American beer, tonight, let it be Löwenbräu.
You guys have any luck today?
Not till now.
Let it be Löwenbräu.
Federal officials have fined Rockwell International $420 for an accident at Cape Canaveral that killed two technicians working on the space shuttle. In March, Rockwell employees John Bjorstad and Forrest Cole were asphyxiated when they unknowingly walked into a section of the shuttle that was filled with nitrogen gas. The $420 fine was levied for exposing employees to a potentially hazardous situation without sufficient testing to see if the area was safe. Meantime, the widows of the two technicians are suing the space agency for $23 million. Miami police, keeping secret the exact location, said today they have found the weapon used to kill police officer Nathaniel Broom last Wednesday. Police say that the man charged with the murder, 23-year-old Robert Patton, seen here in a court appearance this week, stashed the gun at his grandmother's house shortly after the shooting. It was a .38 caliber revolver. There is now a $1,000 reward for anyone who can help police find 11-year-old Christine Anderson of Fort Lauderdale. That offer coming after a search today turned up nothing. Volunteers handed out flyers with Christine's picture and description. She was last seen 6 days ago getting into an old light blue Cutlass with an 18-year-old white male. In Broward County, the beaches are often blanketed by layers of trash on weekends, and a group of civic-minded senior citizens says excuses for that are nothing but rubbish. Karen Nash reports the seniors have begun their own cleanup.
White sandy beaches are one of the benefits of living in South Florida, but the pleasure they can give is often ruined by the carelessness of the people who use them.
Trash on the beach destroys the natural beauty. That's what a half dozen senior citizens felt last November when they formed the Beach Angels. Now there are 40 members who volunteer several hours each week to pick up the litter. They don't mind helping out, but the Beach Angels believe people enjoying the beach should take some responsibility.
We're getting tired of picking everything up for other people. If they don't throw it down, we don't have to pick it up. It's as simple as that.
They took that message to beachgoers today, accompanied by city officials and a state representative.
We have quite a problem. We have contracted a beach service
that cleans up the beach 5 days a week, but on weekends, the beach piles up with a lot of trash. So we're very grateful to the Beach Angels for coming out and doing the job. I wish more people were civic-minded, and instead of throwing the trash, that they would put it in the garbage containers that we provide for them, the city provides for them.
The Beach Angels will be carrying their signs as well as their buckets and their litter getters throughout the busy Labor Day weekend. They hope to inspire as many people as possible to follow their example and pick up any trash they see. Picnics on the beach are permitted and even encouraged along Pompano's shoreline, while other cities have had to prohibit them because of the mess often left behind. City officials say they wouldn't like to see that happen here. It takes so little effort to keep the beach pleasant for everyone. Karen Nash, Channel 4 News, Pompano Beach.
Well, that inspection sticker in the corner of your car windshield will soon be nothing more than a collector's item. Throughout the state, auto inspection stations are closing down. Lee Minella reports from Palm Beach.
The county's auto inspection program is almost at an end. With fewer and fewer motorists taking part in the program, the county commission has decided to close its three remaining stations before the end of this month. That's when the state inspection law is erased from the books once and for all. This station in West Palm Beach and another in Delray Beach will be the last to go on September 26th. The third station in Riviera Beach will be closed at the end of next week. Two others in the county had been closed last month. With the exception of several who intend to retire when all the stations are shut down, inspectors have already been transferred to other positions with the county. About the only problem that remains now is determining what will become of the five buildings. But with many departments clamoring for a chance to use them, county officials don't expect much difficulty in putting them to good use. Lee Minella, Channel 4 News, Palm Beach County.
If you missed the end of the UM Florida game today, well, you missed everything. Chris Myers will have some thrilling highlights right after this.
Do you need a credit card? Have you ever applied and been denied? Were you told your credit report was negative, or you have limited credit references? If you're gainfully employed or have other income, the Credit Club, a new concept in credit services, will help you qualify for the major credit cards you want. For information, call now. Operators are standing by. Call toll-free. 1-800-432-7999. 1-800-432-7999.
Do you need a green card or other legal status in the United States? I'm Gerald Kaiser. President Reagan recently proposed amnesty for illegal aliens. If amnesty is granted, find out if you qualify under the guidelines. We will also help you qualify based on your occupation, business affiliation, or relationship to a United States citizen or permanent resident. To schedule a complimentary consultation, call 371-8600, 371-8600.
Do you know me? I'm high, you can tell. I've owned some of the finest restaurants in the world. In New York, there's El Morocco and Voisin. In Miami, I put my reputation online every night at Nick and Arthur's and The Place for Steak. I pride myself on serving the finest beef available. Here on my farm in Davie, we raise our own Black Angus. There are no shortcuts in my business. People expect quality, we give them quality. Visit us at The Place for Steak in Nick and Arthur's.
There are only two ways to save a bundle on this Kenwood receiver. One way is to buy it before the Sound Advice scratch and dent sale ends Monday. The other way is illegal. Right now, you can save 50% on factory fresh hi-fi and video, even more on scratched and dented items. But the Sound Advice scratch and dent sale ends this Monday night, and it would be, well, a crime if you miss it.
What a game. We left for dinner tonight thinking Florida had it in the bag, but oh, were we surprised.
By the time you finished your dessert, Bob.
Yes.
The Canes had pulled it out. You couldn't have asked for a better finish in today's Miami-Florida clash in the Orange Bowl. The Hurricanes won on a late field goal by Dan Miller, 21-20. Now, Howard Schnellenberger had said that this would be the kind of game that you'd tell your grandchildren about, and he was right. Nearly 74,000 fans jammed into the Orange Bowl to see a rematch of last year's contest in which the Canes had won easily, but this one would be different. This first series field goal by Miller
gave the UM an early 3-0 lead. Mistakes then took their toll on the Canes. 5 turnovers in the first half, and this was one of them, an interception for Dave Galloway, who returned it all the way to the Miami 7. Jim Kelly had to make the stop. And then Gator running back James Jones swept right for 7 yards and a touchdown, making it 7-3. Moving into the second quarter, after another interception, Florida quarterback Wayne Pease hit Spencer Jackson for a 37-yard touchdown and a 14-3 Florida halftime lead. And then the Hurricanes in the second half took the kickoff. They marched 82 yards and for a touchdown. This 24-yard gainer, Kelly to Rodrigue, was the key play. Miami got two afterwards and trailed 14-11 in the third quarter. In that quarter, Jim Kelly, after a handoff, went to block and he fell down. He severely bruised his calf muscle, was forced to leave the game. Mark Richt comes in and tries to get on the board, but off the hands of Larry Brodsky, the Gators come up with the interception, setting up a 48-yard field goal by Brian Clark. He hits. He later adds another 3-pointer to mount a 20-11 fourth quarter Florida lead. And the Hurricane fireworks started after that. Rick found Rocky Belk, and he legged it out for a 55-yard touchdown with just under 6 minutes remaining. The TD capped a 69-yard drive and brought the Canes to within 2. And with under a minute left, Danny Miller kicks a 55-yard field goal with the help of some wind. Now watch it. It hits the crossbar. Great angle here. The University of Miami led by 1, but it wasn't over yet. The Gators battle back, and their kicker, Brian Clark, gets a shot at a 59-yarder, but this one against the wind, and he misses. The Hurricanes pull it out. Final score, 21-20. It's Miami's fourth straight win over Florida. And it certainly was one to remember. I'm not exactly certain how many of these folks will remember anything by tomorrow morning, but there is some celebrating going on in these parts tonight. This is a live shot from the University of Miami Rathskeller, and you can see quite a party going on. The Miami locker room, of course, was a scene of jubilance after the game as well, but Howard Schnellenberger wasn't too satisfied.
One of the poorest games offensively that we've played here. It reminded me of some of them we lost in 1979. What did we have, 5 turnovers or 6?
5 turnovers in the first half.
Yeah, 5 in the first half. You know, you're lucky ever to win a game where you had 5 turnovers. I thought our defense played extremely well. The defense kept us in the game long enough for the offense to finally get something accomplished.
Looking at the rest of today's opening collegiate results, FSU 17-0 over Louisville, Grambling a 21-10 winner, Southern over Bethune-Cookman, not much scoring there, Georgia blew out Tennessee behind Herschel Walker, Alabama in the fourth quarter, leading LSU 24-0, Pittsburgh over Illinois by 20, it was Mississippi State 20-3 over Memphis State, Kentucky an easy winner, Auburn by 8 over TCU, Clemson bombed Wolford 45-10, Texas A&M rallied to beat California by a point, BYU with some passing over Long Beach State, East Carolina beat West Carolina 42-6, South Carolina over Wake Forest 23-6, Mississippi by 1 over Tulane, NC State by 6 over Richmond, and it was Houston 21, New Mexico 10. At the U.S. Open Tennis Championships today, top-seeded John McEnroe breezed into the fourth round with an easy win over Pat Dupre. Vitas Karolaitis did also at the expense of Harold Solomon, but Jose Luis Clerc needed 5 sets to beat Mel Purcell. Dave Martin has highlights of other matches.
Ivan Lendl in the near court, the number 3 seed from Czechoslovakia, ousted Mark Vines in 4 sets. Alicia Moulton in the near court gave defending champion Chris Evert Lloyd a mild scare, winning 3 games in the first set. Chris won this rally and appears to be in fine form. She grew stronger as the match progressed to win 6-3, 6-love. Chris's next opponent is the number 12 seed, Bettina Bungy. Tracy Austin dropped the first 3 games to Pam Cassell, but won the last 12. Miss Austin, the number 3 seed, defeated Pam 6-3, 6-love. Dave Martin for CBS News, New York.
In baseball, the Houston Astros still lead the National League West, but their 9-game winning streak is no longer intact. In Montreal today, the Expos cooled off Houston 5-2, and this home run by Miami and Andre Dawson gave Montreal a quick 2-0 lead. It was his 20th of the year, and it came off Don Sutton. Rookie Tim Raines also homered, but the winning or deciding run came when Gary Carter bounced out with the bases loaded. It could have been a double play ball, but Phil Garner made a bad throw, allowing Rodney Scott to score. The Expos go on to win. Elsewhere in the National League, the Mets were 4-2 winners over the Braves. In tonight's action, Chicago beating San Francisco 8-2, Philadelphia 5-4 over Cincy in the 6th inning, the Pirates shutting out San Diego, the Cardinals doing the same to the Dodgers, that's in the 4th. In the American League, the Indians took a pair from the Angels by identical 4-2 scores, the Red Sox blasted Seattle, the Yanks beat KC 2-1, Milwaukee took Minnesota, Oakland defeated Baltimore 5-3 in the 9th inning, Toronto leading Chicago 3-1, and Detroit a final shutout Texas 1-0. The National Football League season officially got underway tonight in Tampa, and a final score in, Tampa Bay beat the Minnesota Vikings 21-3. 21-13. The Dolphins are in St. Louis tonight for their season opener tomorrow against the Cardinals. Miami is blessed, of course, with an excellent core of receivers, Nat Moore, Duriel Harris, Jimmy Cephalo, and second-year man Elmer Bailey. Don Shula is going to be rotating his receivers a lot this year. Right now, though, Bailey doesn't expect to play much.
Well, right now, it's just the three, Jimmy, Duriel, and Nat, exchange going in the first rotation. And I guess where I'm more or less like a safety valve. If they, you know, get tired or somebody gets hurt, then, you know, I'm available. But right now, I'm more or less going to concentrate on my special team effort. And when my number gets called, I just go out and do it.
I was going to ask you, do you feel a little bit left out in that they're rotating the three and not number 88?
Well, not really. Like I said, I feel a lot better this year because we got a tough schedule. And I'm not really going to say I don't hope nobody gets hurt or anything, but it's going to call. The season's going to call basically for four receivers contributing.
And, Bob, that's sports.
Ever tried karate?
No.
Maybe we can persuade you. Most of us would like to keep in shape, and all of us probably hope that the years will be kind to us. And karate, believe it or not, might be just the thing to help you achieve that goal. One of the highest-ranking karate masters in the world is in Miami this week for a series of demonstrations and special classes for followers of the ancient martial art. Tamasuburo Okano is a seventh-degree black belt from Japan. Now, that in itself is achievement enough, but Okano is almost 60 years old, having been involved with karate for 43 years. This afternoon at the Kinko Juko Karate School in North Miami, he showed admiring students how a master does it. Master Okano says karate is for everybody, not only for defense, but to keep the mind and the body in tune. Discipline, he says, is the key, 2 to 3 hours of practice every day, and for Master Okano, at least, a very light diet consisting mainly of sesame seeds and dried fish. Sounded good until that last part. We'll be right back.
Yeah, there it is.
Good out of here.
Hey, Mike, pass the milk.
Coming your way, Gordy.
Nice catch, Gordy.
Rosie, I never miss.
I think you just went into a slump.
Get something quick, Rosie.
Catch this, Gordy. Bounty starts quicker.
Wow.
So you finish quicker.
Hey, you mean only Bounty works that fast, Rosie?
It has to with all the big league bumblers like Gordy around here. Come on, I'll prove it. A top challenger here and Bounty here.
Hey. Bounty starts working a lot quicker.
Like I said, Bounty starts quicker.
So you finish quicker. Gee, that's great.
And now Mike will show us how strong Bounty is.
Huh?
Mike, put that pie on here.
Boy, that is strong. We're convinced, Rosie, Bounty's the champ.
Around here, it's gotta be.
Hey, Rosie, catch.
I never miss.
Ooh.
Bounty's a quicker picker-upper. Starts quicker, so you finish quicker.
I never had it so good. I never had it so good. I never had it so good since I discovered Nature's Organics Plus Henna Shampoo and Conditioner.
With more natural henna extract than any leading shampoo or conditioner.
Just look at the shine, body, and bounce, and it won't change the color of your hair.
For really beautiful hair, try Nature's Organics Plus Henna Shampoo and Conditioner for shine,
body,
and bounce.
Available at Eagle Family Discount Stores.
Furniture history's been made at Save-On. This is J.R.
And Brother Bob with our 3-for-1 sale.
You'd expect to pay $288 for this 4-piece Herculon living room set alone.
But during our 3-for-1 sale, for $288, you also get this 3-piece bedroom, dresser, mirror, and headboard.
Plus, you get a fabulous 5-piece dinette set, mica top table, and 4 matching chairs.
Yes, 3-for-1, luxurious 4-piece living room, bedroom, and dining room at amazingly low $288.
And you still get 120 days free layaway at the sale price.
Don't you dare miss it.
At Save-On Furniture, Miami, the 79th Street Mall, Perrine, Medley Hialeah, and Opa-locka.
We've still got some leftover problems, I guess you'd call them, from Tropical Storm Dennis, and now another problem.
Hurricane Floyd.
If it continues its present course, how soon will it get here?
Well, I think Monday night or Tuesday, if it continues its present course. And the steering currents are very light, so it might not even get here. We'll take a look at exactly where it's at in just a moment. First, let's look at those current conditions out at Miami International. 83, 79 up at Fort Lauderdale, and 82 at West Palm Beach. Barometer is 29, 97 and rising. Humidity, 79%. Winds out of the east at 10, and no report on that surf temperature. On the radar, let's first look at that. that. We have a few showers continuing out in the western parts of Dade and Broward, actually even over closer into the Glades. Some more showers and thunderstorms continue offshore. These should continue into the nighttime hours, probably into the early morning hours, and then they should diminish, and probably tomorrow afternoon we'll have another round, about a 50% chance of rain in our area. Now let's take a look at Hurricane Floyd. As you see on our satellite, we have him located out near Puerto Rico, actually north of Puerto Rico, moving to the northwest at about 10 miles per hour. Now those current coordinates are 23.0 north, 68.0 west, and with that track and those coordinates, it's bringing it right up the chute toward our region. Now as I said, the steering currents are very light, so we're not really sure where it's going to go, but there are hurricane warnings out for Turk and Caicos Islands, and a hurricane watch out for part of the southern Bahamas. Floyd moving toward the northwest. That current national map looks like this. We have a cold front out in the west that's bringing cooler air down into the northwestern United States, flooding along the front down in and around Utah. But we have a lot of sunshine, well, at least sunny until the sun went down, from the southwestern United States all the way up to near the Great Lakes. But another low pressure area is bringing rain to the Great Lakes, warm, stormy conditions throughout the southeastern United States. Now let's look at the forecast for some of our favorite cities after we take a look at the forecast for Florida. 90 degree temperatures throughout the interior of the state, 80 degree temperatures all the way around the exterior of the state, and that should bring some afternoon thunderstorms to our area, especially in the western part of the state and up in the north, partly cloudy skies right down along the coastal area itself. Now let's look at some forecast temperatures around the nation. Forecast looks like this. Scattered thunderstorms, a low 76, high 89. The boating forecast looks good. Winds east at 10, seas 3 feet or less, and the bays will have a light chop. Bob, that's all we have except for Floyd.
Have a good Sunday.
Okay.
Tomorrow, a group of young athletes of sorts will be turning in a sizable amount of money to help in the battle against muscular dystrophy. Robin Carter has the story.
Philip the Fool, down there number one.
These jugglers may not juggle their way into the Guinness Book of World Records, but they may help juggle up the figures in the Jerry Lewis Telethon. These men juggled for 4 hours straight in the burning sun to raise money for muscular dystrophy.
Can you possibly keep this up?
I don't know. It's pretty difficult.
Whatever it takes to lick muscular dystrophy.
The marathon juggling contest was held at the Park West Mall in Kendall, and merchants here pledged $100 for each juggler. Now, the object was to juggle for the longest amount of time with the fewest amount of drops. The jugglers got only 1 5-minute break every hour and an occasional hose down to cool off.
This is very, very tiring. I've never gone this long before in my life. I will never do it again.
Not all of the jugglers were professional magicians. Some were just regular teenagers, like 13-year-old Randy Goodman.
You think you're going to make it till 4 o'clock? You just dropped one.
I'm going to try. I'm just going to try to hang in there. It's for a good cause.
Al Myers is now in first place in the second straight hour of the Plaza West Budweiser Juggling Marathon.
I'm going to go the whole time. I'm going to end. I'm going to finish. And I'm going to win.
But Hal Myers didn't win. After juggling for 4 hours straight, he lost by only 2 drops to 17-year-old Ted Allaire, a high school student. Ted will get $200 for his effort. In all, the contest brought in over $3,200 for the Muscular Dystrophy Telethon. Robin Carter, Channel 4 News.
And that completes this edition of News Weekend. Thank you for joining us. Good night.